Good morning, everyone. My name is Dr. R.S. Gupta. I'm a professor in the Department of Biochemistry at McMaster University, Canada. I thank the organizers for this conference for inviting me to speak on the occasion of superannuation of Dr. Ramachandra. I've known Dr. Ramachandra since mid-1980, when he spent 2 years as a postdoctoral fellow in my lab. Dr. Ramachandra was one of the most dedicated and capable researchers who have passed through my lab. And it was expected that he will become a leader in the field of genetics. Dr. Ramachandra's stay in my lab predated the genomic era, as the work that I'll be speaking today has not yet begun, but its foundations were laid during that time. As the other speakers in this conference has indicated, genome sequences have revolutionized all areas of biology and health sciences. However, one area where genome sequences have a particularly dramatic impact relates to understanding the evolutionary relationships among microorganisms. So for the past 15, 20 years, research work in my lab has primarily focused on understanding the evolutionary relationships among microorganisms. So to begin with, let me give you an overview of the current understanding of evolutionary relationship among microorganisms. Now, the evolutionary relationship among microorganisms is commonly determined based on phylogenetic tree, and most of it is currently based on 16S or small subunit ribosomal RNA trees. But as the genome sequences have become available, it's also possible to construct tree based on large number of data sets of proteins or gene sequences. However, in all of the constructed phylogenetic trees, the different groups of organisms are found to form various clades. And in the case of prokaryotic organisms, about 30 to 40 different clades are seen in the phylogenetic trees. However, the trees have a number of limitations. One of them is that the branching order of the different organism or species, main clades in the trees are not reliably resolved. Second thing, based on the tree, it's difficult to reliably demarcate the boundaries of any given clade. And the third important limitation of the phylogenetic trees is that the trees, they do not provide any genetic or biochemical properties that is commonly shared by a given group of organisms. For 5 years, the main focus of our work has been aimed at identifying, using genome sequences to identify novel molecular markers or characteristics that are specific for different groups of organisms. And in my lab, the work that we have done, we have pioneered the studies of discovery of two types of molecular markers. One of them we refer to as conserved signatures, inserts or deletions, or CSIs, and the others are conserved signature proteins. And I will briefly, in the next few slides, I will briefly indicate what these two types of markers are and how they are useful for understanding, gaining information about different types of organisms. So this particular slide shows you the example of a conserved signature indel. In this slide or cartoon, basically what I have shown you is a partial sequence alignment of a protein. And in this region, this is highly conserved region of the protein, and all of the dashes in the sequence in this slide, they indicate sequence identity with the amino acid on the top line. So what you observe here is that there are different species, X1, X2, or A1A2 to X1, X2. They could be organisms at different phylogenetic level. They could be phylum, order, family, or species. Now, what you see here in this diagram is that all of the members of group X, they contain this large insert, which is shown in this box, whereas all other species or all other organisms, they lack this particular insert. And this insert is present in a conserved region, and it's flanked by, on both sides, by region indicating that it's a reliable characteristics. So just to indicate that the Kanjar windles that are useful for phylogenetic or biological studies, they are flanked on both sides with Kanjar regions. And these Kanjar regions ensures that the indel is reliable and it's not a resulting from any kinds of artifactual alignment or other characteristics. These types of indels are present at different phylogenetic depths. They could be specific for phylum, they could be specific for order, genus, family, and even subspecies and substrains of species. And I will give you in my talk, I will give examples of indels that are specific at different phylogenetic level. Now, the inferences based on these Kanjar indels are also generally not affected by other limitations of phylogenetic tree construction methods, such as lateral gene transfers. Now, these based on these CSIs, one can also root them based upon the absence or presence of these CSIs in the ancestral species. One can determine whether the insert in question, indel in question, is an insert or a deletion. If all the other outgrouped species are lacking the indel, then the indel is an insert. Otherwise, if the outgrouped species are containing the indel, then the indel is a deletion. So this is an example of indel. Now, these indels, they have number of, they possess number of very important and useful characteristics. One of the properties is this constancy, that these are highly reliable characteristics, and they both small and large indels both are equally reliable. Here I'm showing you an example of an indel in the HSP60 protein that was identified in my lab in 1995, that's predating the sequencing of any genome. At that time, based on the available genome sequences, it was inferred that this indel is a shared properties of gram-negative bacteria and as well as eukaryotic organism, but it's absent in all other gram-positive bacteria. Now, over the years, large number of genome sequences have become available. And as every genome gets sequenced, if one can examine the presence or absence of these sequences in different genomes, and as I have indicated in the slide on the right, that these indels are highly reliable characteristics. So, for example, in the 2010, the number of genome sequences are increasing, but the presence, expected presence of or indel in the indicated group is highly correlated with the particular group. So, for example, all 1,500 species from at that time in 2010 contained this indel, whereas all of the species from this group did not contain, and one or two exceptions were because of gene duplication event. So these indels are highly reliable characteristics. Another important characteristics of these indels is that they are also essential for the group of species where they are found. For this particular indel, we have carried out extensive experimental work where we have either removed this indel by experimental means or made changes, changed the amino acid in this position by means of molecular methods. And again, any kind of change in this in the insert position, either the absence or major change in this indel sequence, is incompatible for cellular growth, indicating that these inserts or deletions are playing important functions in the organisms where they are found. Now, this particular slide, it gives you an example of the Kanjar signature proteins. Now, unlike the indel, where the protein in question or the gene or protein in question is present in different organisms, these signature proteins are uniquely found in a particular group of organisms. And in this particular slide, I'm showing you the results of blast searches with a protein which is only found in Borrelia species. So in this case, all of the blast hits, significant blast hits, are for Borrelia species. And except for Borrelia species, there's no other significant blast hits are observed. So this protein or gene is entirely uniquely found in Borrelia species. Now, so in my talk, I'll be describing different examples of uses of these Kanjar indels for understanding the evolutionary relationships among different organisms, and also I will be describing some applications of these conserved minerals for a number of studies. So I will, my talk today will focus on maybe three main areas. One is I would be looking at evolutionary relationships among mycobacteria and how our understanding of that has been advanced by genomic sequences. I will also be then looking at briefly at the evolutionary relationship and classification of species from the order Enterobacterial, which include E. coli and related species. And finally, I will discuss some potential applications of the identified molecular signatures for diagnostic and therapeutic developments. So let me begin with the indicate to you the importance of Mycobacterium. So genus Mycobacterium contains more than 200 different species. And these species include Mycobacterium tuberculosis and leprae, which are the causative agent of tuberculosis and leprosis. However, most mycobacterial species are not pathogenic, and many of them are commonly found in water and soil. However, there are no reliable means exists or existed until about a few years ago for distinguishing the pathogenic mycobacterial species from non-pathogenic mycobacterial species. And also there were very few molecular or genetic characteristics were known that were specific for the disease-causing organisms like Mycobacterium tuberculosis and leprae. So using available genome sequences for Mycobacterium species, we have carried out extensive phylogenetic and comparative genomic analysis. So on this particular slide, this work which has been published in 2018, so in this particular work, we have, first of all, we have carried out what you call phylogenomic trees. And these trees were based on very large data sets of protein sequences. So basically, the one of the trees is based on the 1,040 core proteins that are commonly shared by all mycobacterial species. And likewise, the second protein is also based on 136 conserved proteins that are commonly shared by all actinobacteria. Now, you won't be able to see all the details of these trees, but basically the main point here is that in these phylogenetic trees, all the known mycobacterial species, they form five distinct clades. And these are very strongly supported clades. And these species from these clades are shown in different colors in this tree for you to easily see that how they are distinguished from each other. And this particular diagram on the right, it shows a conceptual diagram indicating the main clades and names that we have given to them. Okay, so these are the five different clades of mycobacterial species that are seen in different phylogenetic tree. Now, the phylogenetic tree, as I mentioned previously, they do not tell you anything about what unique properties are shared by different groups of microorganisms. And also the branching order of the species in tree can often be variable. And because in most cases, it's difficult to construct trees such as the one that are shown on the right. And most cases, trees are based on 16S ribosomal RNA or other single genes, which are not very reliable. So our next task was to identify genome sequences to identify molecular markers that are specific for different clades of Mycobacterium species. So here in this diagram, I'm showing you some examples of molecular markers. So for example, in this case on the right, the panel on the right, it shows a 6 amino acid insert, which is uniquely shared by all member of this abscessus chelone clade. Okay, and this is just one example of the CSI that is specific for this clade. But in our work, we have identified 27 different CSI in different proteins, as well as 24 conserved signature proteins that are uniquely shared by all members of abscessus chelone clade, but they are not present in any other Mycobacterium species. Likewise, the diagram below, it shows an indel, which is specific for the Fortutum wacky clade. These are this particular group of Mycobacterium, they are also referred to as fast-growing mycobacterial species. So again, this 5 amino acid insert is uniquely shared by all 46 members from this clade, but it's not present in any other bacteria. And again, we have identified multiple CSIs and CSPs that are specific for this clade of Mycobacterium. Now, in this diagram, I'm showing you other CSIs and CSPs, which are specific for other clades of Mycobacteria. This is a terry clade. And again, we are describing to you, I'm describing here this particular CSI, which is specific for terry clade. Multiple CSIs and CSPs have been identified. And this is the tuberculosis simia clade. This particular clade contains species such as Mycobacterium lepre and Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and these are slow growing Mycobacteria. And again, we have multiple, several CSIs, which are uniquely found in the member of this clade, but not present in other Mycobacterium species. So based upon large number of molecular signatures that are specific for each of these different clades of Mycobacteria, which, and they, based on these markers, these clades can be identified not only in phylogenetic term, but in reliable molecular terms. And as I mentioned previously, these markers have high degree of predictive ability. So they are expected to be present in other members, other species from these clade as well. So based on these studies, what we have basically, this is showing you a summary of the results from these studies that we have carried out. So all of these different clades, we can identify and in molecular term. So this work, based on this work, we have divided the genus Mycobacterium into four novel genera and an amended or a delimited genus Mycobacterium. So for example, the other the species from the this other genera, they are now given by the different other clades, they are given new names. So the species from abscessus chelonoclade, they are now referred to by the name, new name, Mycobacteroides. Species from the rapid growing clade, they are referred to as Mycolisi bacterium. Species from the terry clade, they are referred to as Mycolisi bacter. And only the species from the simiae and tuberculosis clade, they are referred to now by the genus Mycobacterium. So genus Mycobacterium is now limited to only this group of species, which include tuberculosis, leprosy, and other related slow-growing Mycobacteria, which are generally disease-causing bacteria. And all species from these clades are known by these new names that we have given based on our work. So this work, it was published in 2018, and I have indicated this work has been highly impactful. There are already more than 190 citations to this work indicating the importance of this class, new classification that we have proposed for the Mycobacterium species based on genomic analysis. Now here I want to describe, we have focused little, carried out some further work on members of the Mycobacterium clade. So as I mentioned, Mycobacterium clade, the delimited Mycobacterium clade, it contains Mycobacterium tuberculosis, leprosy, as well as it contains a number of other species. But still this clade is fairly large. And as the Mycobacterium tuberculosis, as we know, is a single most infectious disease-causing organism. There are more than about 1.6 million deaths per year from this disease. And many of these strains of Mycobacterium tuberculosis, they have developed resistance to all available antibiotics. So there's a novel, and particularly in the context of India, the incidence of tuberculosis is fairly high in India. So there's a lot of, there's an urgency to develop novel means for rapid detection of tuberculosis or mTuberculosis, and also importance for developing novel means for treatment of drug-resistant form of tuberculosis. So we recently published another paper where we discuss identify molecular markers, okay, how genome sequences can lead to identification of potential targets for diagnostic and therapeutics of tuberculosis. So in this work, we have carried out again in detail further analysis of members of the tuberculosis clades. And the tuberculosis clade, like I mentioned, it again contains, it's a fairly, the species from this clade again form multiple distinct other clades. So like these are species from the lepre clade, and there are other clades, simia clade, okay, and different other clades that are part of this clade. Okay, but all of the species from the which cause tuberculosis, they are part of this tight complex referred to as the tuberculosis complex. So this includes species like Mycobacterium tuberculosis, Mycobacterium microti, and so on, and are very closely related species. So in this work, we have focused on identifying molecular signatures that are specific for the tuberculosis complex of bacteria, which are the main species responsible for tuberculosis causation. And I'm showing here two different CSIs in two important proteins. Okay, one is this MERB protein, and again, this is this H protein. So again, in both cases, these conserved inserts shown in the colored boxes, they are specific for the tuberculosis complex of species. All nine members of the tuberculosis complex of species contain these inserts, whereas all other mycobacteria or other bacteria, none of them, they contain these CSIs. And these CSIs, as one can see, they are present in highly conserved regions. And so we have, as a result of our work, we have identified, in fact, a very large number of CSIs. In fact, we have identified 63 CSIs that are uniquely shared by members of the tuberculosis complex or bacteria. So these CSIs provide us novel tools for different types of studies that I will describe briefly later on. So now let me briefly move on to the uses or impact of genomic studies on clarifying the relationship among members of the order Enterobacterial, which include E. coli and related species. So here I've indicated in this summary diagram, okay, the our understanding of the order Enterobacterial before 2016, that is before we undertook the study, our genomic studies on this. So before 2016, the order Enterobacterial, it contained a single family, Enterobacteriaceae, and within this, the E. coli is a part of this family. So as I've indicated, this order contained a single order, a single family, and within this, there were different types of species and many different genera. Okay, more than 50 genera are part within this family, and this contained different kinds of plant pathogens as well as animals and human pathogens. So animal pathogens include Salmonella, Yersinia, and of course, E. coli, pathogenic E. coli. And so this was a highly diverse group of family or order. And there was no distinction made about how different large number of species that are present with this disorder are related to each other. So we undertook detailed studies similar to that I've described for the genus Mycobacterium. And we these studies were published in 2016 in this paper that I have described here. And in this case, our work identified a large number of CSIs which are specific for the order Enterobacterial. So five of these CSIs were commonly shared by all Enterobacterial, whereas large number of other CSIs, okay, they were specific for different clades of within Enterobacterial. And all of these clades which are shown here, they're reliably distinguished in genome-based phylogenetic trees, which are not shown here. So these trees, these clades are distinct based on their phylogenetic branching pattern. But then importantly, we have identified large number of molecular signatures which are unique to this group of these particular clades of species, enabling their identification in molecular term. So based upon these studies, our work led to division of the order Enterobacterials into seven families. Okay, so the family Enterobacteriaceae was reduced to a small number of this particular group, whereas all the other Enterobacterial species were divided into these families. And again, our classification is now widely established, broadly established. And as one can see, since 2016, this paper has been cited 200 and almost 300 times. And it's one of the most highly cited paper in this particular journal and in this particular area. Okay, so leading to the importance of the work that we carried out in this regard. Now, we have further focused, carried out work on Enterobacteriaceae family. So like I mentioned, these were the 6-7 family that we initially divided the order Enterobacterial was divided into, but then now we have focused the work on further work on Enterobacteriaceae family, and further analysis of this family indicated that this family consisted of at least 6 different clades, okay, which we have indicated that as here by different names, and each of these clades could be identified multiple CSIs, and these are subfamily level clades. Okay, although we have not proposed a formal classification of these clades into subfamily, but this possibly will be occurring in the coming months or year. Okay, but the point is that all of this, we can now clearly distinguish these different clades of bacteria in both phylogenetic terms and molecular terms. Now, I want to describe some further work about the Escherichia clade. It contains E. coli as well as number of related species. And I have indicated here one CSI, which is specific for the Escherichia clade. So Escherichia clades include species, members of the genus Escherichia, Citrobacter, Salmonella, the 4 genera that are part of this particular clade. And so we have identified large number of CSIs, which are specific for this clade. And then within this clade, we have carried out further work where we have looked for CSI specific for either different genera that are part of Escherichia clade, as well as the figure on the right shows a CSI with members of the Escherichia genus. They contain this particular CSI, but this CSI is not present in other members of the clade. So again, based on the CSIs, one can in molecular terms, we can identify the order Enterobacterial, we can identify the family Enterobacteriaceae, we can identify this subfamily which we refer to as Escherichia clade, as well as we can identify the genus E. coli Escherichia in molecular terms. Now, this approach that I have described for identification of molecular signatures, this is not limited only to the prokaryotic organism or microorganism, but this can also be used for identification of signatures specific for different eukaryotic organisms. And I won't have time to go into it, but based on using the same approach, our work has provided important insights into the evolutionary relationship among higher organism. But like, for example, in this particular we identified large number of signatures that are specific for vertebrates species and how vertebrate species are related to other members of the phylum Chordata. And in other studies, we have looked at molecular signature specific for the Plasmodium as well as nematode species as well. So now I will move over briefly to the applications of the discovered CSIs and CSPs. I've indicated that CSIs and CSPs, they allow demarcation of different groups in molecular terms, and they have proven very useful for evolutionary and classification studies. And the properties of the CSI that I've indicated is that they exhibit high degree of specificity for the indicated group of organism. They also indicate high degree of predictive ability that other organisms from these groups will also contain these CSIs, even if though their sequences are not available or those such organisms have not been discovered. So because of these properties, the predictive ability and specificity, these CSIs and CSPs, they provide important means for development of novel diagnostics and therapeutics. Furthermore, like I mentioned, all of these CSIs are present in important proteins, and if they changes, and I've also indicated that these CSIs are important, they play essential role in the given organisms. So although the functions of these CSIs are not known, but it's expected as further genetic and biochemical studies are carried out on these molecular or genetic characteristics, it would lead to discovery of novel properties that are specific for different groups of microorganism or organisms. Now here I have indicated how these CSIs and CSPs can be used for diagnostic development of novel diagnostic assay. So for example, if you have a CSP, which is specific for different given group of organism, one can design PCR primers based on it. And this PCR primer will only amplify, give a positive result for the given group of organism. All other groups of organism, because they do not contain this gene for this CSP, you should not see any positive results. So they provide important means for development of highly specific diagnostic assay. Likewise, in the case of CSIs, okay, where the gene may be present in other organisms as well, one can design PCR primers that are flanking the conserved the CSI based on conserved regions that are flanking. And in this case, based on the size differences between the amplified fragment that are amplified, right? One can again distinguish whether the organism, whether the amplification is because of the presence of the indicated group of organisms or not. And we have carried out as a proof for a principle for this approach. We have used the CSI approach for development of a highly specific assay for Bacillus anthracis. And this work was carried out in collaboration with a group in Public Health England or Health Protection Agency in UK. And in this, the species Bacillus anthracis is based on 16S ribosomal RNA. Its sequence is identical to that of the Bacillus serous. So very difficult to distinguish these two groups of organism based on 16S ribosomal RNA. So in this particular study, which was, like I mentioned, was carried out in collaboration, we identified a large indole, okay, in fact, a 24 amino acid indole or 72 base pair indole, which was specific for Bacillus anthracis. And the specificity of this indole for Bacillus anthracis was determined based on examination of large number of available strains. So it's a highly specific deletion, which is found only in Bacillus anthracis and not present in any other Bacillus species. So based on this large indole, we developed both a PCR, conventional PCR-based assay. Because of the large indole, one can easily distinguish the Bacillus serous, which leads to amplification of a larger fragment as opposed to Bacillus anthracis species. At the same time, we also developed a rapid pyrosequencing assay whereby large number of clones can be, or large number of samples can be at the same time within a short time. They can be determined, they can be examined whether they correspond to Bacillus anthracis or Bacillus serous. Now, this is another example of and the use of conserved indels for the detection of organisms. So like I mentioned, there are certain groups of E. coli which are highly pathogenic, and particularly E. coli 015787 is responsible for many outbreaks of gastrointestinal diseases. And this is a very important concern because these species can be contaminating water resources or other agricultural food products. Right, for food. And so this is, it leads to a major problem. So in this case, we identified a conserved insert which was uniquely present in the, which was specific for the this particular clade of organisms. And it's indicated here that this three amino acid insert in a highly conserved region was only found in the 015787 related strains, and all different strains were examined to establish its specificity. And whereas all other E. coli do not contain this particular insert. And so based on this, we have developed a PCR TACMAN probe, okay, for quantitative PCR analysis. And this and the specificity of probe and the usefulness of this probe was examined for looking at the detection of this 015787 in freshwater environment, and it was shown to be highly specific, and it can detect the presence of this pathogenic organism in water sample at a fairly low concentration. Now, I mentioned that the CSIs can also be used for therapeutic purpose for development of novel therapeutics, and the usefulness of these CSIs as potential therapeutic targets is based on at least three main observations. First of all, these CSIs, as I mentioned, they are highly specific for a given group of organisms. And in most cases, like I mentioned, these are not present in the human homolog because they are present for disease, a particular protein only in a given group of organisms. And we have shown that the human homologs of these proteins, they lack the CSI. Okay, we have also shown that these CSIs, they are the number of proteins that we have examined, that they play essential role there. So whatever function they are carried out, it is essential for the CSI containing organism. And the third thing is that these CSIs are present as surface exposed patches on protein surfaces. Like this is an example of the where this particular CSI, which is specific for mycobacteria and actinobacteria, is located on the surface of the protein. And so these surface exposed loops or patches, they are involved in enabling novel protein-protein or protein-ligand interaction that are essential for this group of organism. So the prediction is that if one carries out chemical screening of small molecules to find small molecules that bind specifically to this CSI, which is the surface exposed CSI, then in these cases, so this is showing you the approach. So this is the CSI containing region, and we can have we can screen small molecule chemical libraries, okay, which could contain millions of compounds, and we can look for compound that may bind specifically to the CSI region. And it's expected that many of these compounds which bind specifically for the CSI, they will prevent or they will interfere with the functioning of the CSI in cellular function. And yes, the function of the CSI are essential. So these compound binding to the CSI will be exhibiting growth inhibitory properties toward this organism. So we have identified large number of compounds that are directed towards the CSI, and we are testing the whether these compounds exhibit antimicrobial activity or not. So in summary, what I have indicated so far what we have carried out using genome sequences, we have identified large number of CSIs and CSPs that are specific for different groups of organisms. And because of that, we can now reliably identify these groups in molecular terms, not only in phylogenetic terms, but molecular terms. Okay, and these molecular terms, and further I have indicated that these CSIs and CSPs exhibit high degree of specificity and predictive ability. And based on them, one can develop different kinds of novel diagnostics as well as potential drug targets. And lastly, because these compounds, these CSIs and CSPs, they are essential for these organisms, they play important role in these organisms. So we expect that further genetic and biochemical studies on these CSIs and CSPs should lead to discovery of many novel properties that distinguish different groups of organisms from each other. Now, here in this particular slide, I have indicated some of the individuals from my lab who have worked in my lab over the years. And these are, in fact, interesting to show that this is Sharat Ramachandra, Dr. Ramachandra's son, who also spent a few months in my lab. And in fact, he was born when Dr. Ramachandra was a postdoctoral fellow in my lab. So my association with Dr. Ramachandra goes back very long time. So lastly, I end my talk by wishing Dr. Ramachandra my heartiest congratulations on reaching this important milestone, and wish him good health and great success in his various leadership roles in the fields of genetics and genomics.